topic is golden hour management of preterm infants.
We now invite Dr. Balakrishnan from the stage. There is an MD fellowship in neonatology from Australia. He's a consultant of the neonatologist from Kobe Medical Center Hospital, Coimbatore. His area of expertise includes non-invasive ventilation and neonatal respiration. Sir has 10 years of experience in neonatology and has many publications to his credit. He is also the state academic coordinator for basic NRP. Over to you, sir, Dr. Balakrishnan.
At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers of Kudwai Pedicon for giving me this opportunity to present this topic on golden hour management of preterm units. So, as you are all aware, one of the most complex physiological adaptation that we see in the entire human life is birth, because that's when a fetus transitions to become a neonate. And this involves multiple organ systems, and adaptation has to happen very quickly. And this is a complex process by itself. And when that happens in a preterm neonate, it's much more complex, because the preterm neonate is ill-prepared to undergo this adaptation. And hence, the way that you manage these babies for the first few hours of life make a significant impact on the baby's neonatal morbidity as well as mortality. So for the next 20 minutes, I'll be discussing on the definition of the golden hour. You will describe the key concerns that we need to address in the first hour of life. And we will identify the strategies which we can utilize to optimize the care in the first hour of life. So this is a slide which shows the state of newborn health in India. So as you can see on the left, there has been a reduction in the IMR and NMR over the last few decades in India, and especially in Tamil Nadu. And what is a significant contributor for neonatal mortality these days is prematurity and the complications which is related to prematurity, which accounts for nearly 40 to 45%. So if you want to come down on the IMR or the NMR further, the next step that we need to take is to reduce the preterm mortality. So this is a slide which shows the graph, shows the increasing survival rates of 23, 24, and 25 weeks in UK. So as you can see, over the last 20 years, the survival rates have gone up by more than 20 to 30%. And it's pretty much the same in India as well, as we see more and more number of extreme preterm neonates surviving. And what this translates to is these babies are at risk of developing later on childhood disabilities. So preterm birth not just contributes to a significant chunk of neonatal mortality, but it's also a contributor for childhood disabilities later in life. So over the last 10 years or so, there have been a lot of quality improvement initiatives to identify strategies which we can implement in our day-to-day care in order to improve the preterm care and reduce the mortality and morbidity. And one of the important quality improvement initiatives that has been opening up or that has been discussed widely is the way that we manage these preterm units for the first 1 hour of life, because that can have a significant impact on a preterm baby's mortality and morbidity. So this concept originated in the trauma care, and it has been proven beyond doubt the way how we manage these adults during 1 hour after trauma and the emergency medicine can have a significant impact on the adult outcome. And the first hour of life is a time of profound and critical transition involving multiple organ system, as I discussed earlier. And the risk of mortality in an infant is at its highest immediately after birth. And management of these babies during this golden hour can have a significant impact on the outcomes as well. So, soon after birth, these babies can develop rapidly hypoglycemia, hypothermia, hypoxemia, respiratory failure. And hence, during the golden hour, what we need to do a complex set of tasks and procedures which must be performed in a systematic, sequential, and efficient manner within a short period of time in order to rapidly stabilize the neonate. And this is how we define the golden hour in the management of preterm neonates. So what are the concerns that we have related to golden hour? We can divide them as short-term concerns and long-term concerns. Short-term include hypothermia, because these babies have larger body surface area. They're at risk of hypotension. They're at risk of hypoglycemia because they've got reduced glycogen stores and they have poor counter-regulatory hormone mechanisms. And the risk of both hypoxia and hyperoxia. Hypoxia because of respiratory distress, and hyperoxia because if we intend to get more oxygen, it can result in free radical injury. And that can cause later on problems like chronic lung disease. And respiratory failure secondary to respiratory distress syndrome. What are the long-term concerns that we have? One of the important is intraventricular hemorrhage. As you are all aware, if there is a wide fluctuations in the blood pressure or there has been change in the hemodynamics which happens in the first few hours of life, because of the fragile capillaries in the brain, it can lead on to IBS. Chronic lung disease, again, because of hyperoxia and the way that we manage the initial respiratory care for the first few hours, necrotizing enterocolitis, and ROP, retinopathy of prematurity. So all these concerns can be addressed if we can manage these babies effectively during the first hour of life. So when we go on to what are the components of golden hour, so we can divide it as one which is related to before birth, during birth, and after birth. So before birth, we do the antenatal counseling and team briefing. During birth, we take care of delayed cord clamping and preventing hypothermia in these preterm units. And after birth, in the NICU, we have to rapidly stabilize these units by providing support to the respiratory system, support to the cardiovascular system, then the most important of all, preventing nosocomial infections if they're admitted in the neonatal intensive care. So we'll go one component of the after the other. So antenatal counseling first is to do a risk assessment for the neonatal mortality based on the baby's gestational age as well as the other risk factors which are associated in that neonate. Once we have assessed the risk, we have to communicate the same to the parents. We should have an antenatal counseling session with the parents discussing about the details that what to expect out of the neonate in the NICU. And very important, these two strategies that have to be followed whenever time permits. Give antenatal steroids and antenatal magnesium sulfate, especially for a preterm unit born less than 32 weeks for the mother, because it's known to improve the neuroprotection and neurodevelopmental outcome in the preterm unit. So teamwork is the key mantra, especially in neonatal resuscitation, but it also extends to the golden hour management, wherein we need to identify one person as the team leader, either the pediatrician or the neonatologist. And once we've identified the team leader, we need to identify the team members. Usually the golden hour management requires a consultant followed by a postgraduate or a junior medical officer, then probably two or three nurses. If you have the facility of a respiratory therapist, it should be good as well. There should be an effective communication among the team members during the course of action, and team briefing should be done before the birth regarding the risks and what to expect and how to escalate if the baby is not doing well. And we should also do team briefing at the end of the session after 1 hour to see what has gone well and what needs to be done well the next time. So during birth, what is the simple cost-effective intervention that can be done to improve the preterm outcome is delayed cord clamping. So as you can see on the slide, as we delay the cord clamping, the effective circulating blood volume increases from about 80 to 100 ml per kilo. And as you can see, the baby becomes more and more thinker as we delay the cord clamping. And studies have time and again showed these babies have higher circulating blood volume for the first 24 to 48 hours. Their blood pressures are higher compared to babies who have done early cord clamping. They have a better transition. They require fewer blood transfusions, especially these 28, 29 weekers. They have less need for inotropes in babies for whom we do delayed cord clamping. They have less NEC. And very importantly, they have less incidence of IVS by nearly 50% in preterm babies for whom we do delayed cord clamping. So this is the Cochrane data which says delayed cord clamping reduces the risk of death in delayed cord clamping. Similarly, there is reduction in the risk of IVS as well in delayed cord clamping compared to early cord clamping. So should we do cord milking? No, because this is a study which was published in 2019 which suggests cord milking, there is increased risk of severe IVS compared to delayed cord clamping in preterm units. So what is the current recommendation as per the ILCOR 2020 guidelines, AHA guidelines? We have to delay cord clamping for longer than 30 seconds in preterm and term units, but it's preferred if you can delay up to 1 to 2 minutes if the baby is doing well. Cord milking should never be attempted, especially in preterm units, because there's a sudden gush of blood, sudden increase in blood volume which can result in IVH. Temperature regulation, again, a simple task. The incidence is very high. It's about 31 to 70% of the babies are hypothermic at admission. And every 1 degree fall in temperature can increase the mortality by 28%. We don't realize this. There are various modes of heat loss. So how are we going to circumvent this? In preterm units, we should make sure environmental temperature is more than 25 degrees. Use a radiant warmer in order to reduce the radiation. It's better we use a polyethylene bag or wrap, especially in babies who are born less than 32 weeks. Because once we use this, it reduces the evaporative heat loss. And this has to be done soon after the birth, even before the drying. So even before drying, you cover the baby. Once that is done, it reduces the evaporative loss, and that forms a good humid environment around the baby and reduces the heat loss. if we have a thermopad, which is an exothermic matter, it can reduce the conductive heat loss. And if possible, if you have the facility, it will be better to have a transport warmer or a transport incubator wherein you fit an extreme preterm unit from the labor room or the theater to the NICU. So next comes, how do you stabilize these babies in NICU? So first, with regard to respiratory support. So how are we going to support them? The point that we need to take care is resuscitation with 30% SaO2, providing delivery room CPAP, the role of sustained inflation. How about early rescue surfactants, the use of heat and humidified gas, and gentle ventilation strategy. I'll go one by one. So when we deal with adrenal AVAS for a term baby, we have to initiate resuscitation with 21% oxygen. So initiation of resuscitation should be in air. For a preterm unit, it has to be from 21 to 30%. You can go up to 30%, not beyond 30% when you initiate. Because time and again it has shown that use of 100% of oxygen for resuscitation can cause oxidative stress. And there has been increased mortality for babies if you straight away start using 100% oxygen rather than 30% oxygen. Whereas if you use the 30% oxygen, it results in better clinical outcomes in the form of reduced supplemental oxygen, reduced days of mechanical ventilation, and reduced BPD than with 90% oxygen. So once you have initiated, how to go about further? That's based on your pre-ductal saturation. So the saturation of a term unit who is born gradually increases from about 50 to 60 to 95 by about 10 minutes. So we are not in a hurry to get a saturation of 90 by 2 minutes. So if my baby is saturating 70 at 3 minutes, I'm happy. I don't have to give extra oxygen. But if he's hypoxic, give him more oxygen. But if his saturation is 80 or 90, please reduce the SiO2 that is going to give to the preterm unit. So this will act as a reminder for us while you're resuscitating. And how do we deliver the exact SiO2? We should have blenders. Either a mechanical blender or what we can use in a Y-piece connector wherein the one limb is connected to the air, the other limb is connected to the oxygen. So this is what we use in our NIC for transporting. We have an oxygen cylinder, an air cylinder which is connected by an Y-piece. And we have pasted this in our warmers to know how much SiO2 is being delivered. So if it is 3 and 3, it's 60%. So if the baby is saturating more, we come down on the oxygen, increase the air. If the baby is saturating well, we just get 6 liters of air, no oxygen. Next, delivery room CPAP. It's preferred to have a TPS resuscitator for all preterm deliveries because it provides not just PIP, but also PEEP and CPAP. It helps establish functional residual capacity very early, prevents mechanical ventilation in about 50%. It reduces the need for surfactants in about 11% of the babies, reduces the need for postnatal steroid use. So very important that we use a delivery room CPAP, especially for extreme preterm units. So the time and again, what I would like to tell you is, which is the balloon which is easier to inflate, the balloon which has been partially filled. If somebody gives you a completely collapsed balloon, it takes a long time for you to blow up the balloon. This is what happens soon after birth. In a preterm baby, if you're not going to give a CPAP, the alveoli is going to get completely atlectatic, and it's going to be a demanding task when the baby comes to the NIC to open up all the alveoli. If you had used the delivery room CPAP, this alveoli is not going to collapse completely. It's going to be partially collapsed. And once you start a bubble CPAP in the NICU, you're going to reinflate the lungs much quicker, and thereby you reduce the need for mechanical ventilation and surfactant use. Next is role of sustained inflation. So what is sustained inflation? So when you do a bag and mask ventilation, you give intermittent positive pressure ventilation. Whereas in sustained inflation, we keep the PIP, the PIP, inflating pressure for more than 5 seconds with the hope that it can provide better alveolar recruitment, increasing the pulmonary blood flow and movement of lung fluid. But unfortunately, the last decade, there have been systematic reviews which have showed no significant benefit from sustained lung inflation. And one review found even high risk of death in first 48 hours. So sustained inflation should not be performed. Actually, we were hoping that this would become a routine care for preterm units, but after these reviews, we have stopped using sustained inflation for extreme preterm units. Next, surfactant. So the way that we're going to administer surfactant varies. One is prophylactic, early rescue, and late rescue. As per the 2019 European guidelines, the best method is to give early rescue, which is administered within 2 hours of birth, if the baby is symptomatic, if the baby is RDS, and if the baby fulfills the criteria of SiO2 of more than 30% requirement. Give surfactant as early as possible, preferably within the first 2 hours of birth, because it reduces the need for ventilation, reduces air leaks, pneumothorax, reduces bronchopulmonary dysplasia. If a preterm baby is born, assess the baby early. If baby needs surfactant, give it as early as possible. The way that we give surfactant, mist and lees are preferred over insert. heated and humidified gas, how they do it play a role. As you are all aware, the gas that comes from a medical gas from the central supply, or the gas that comes from a cylinder, the temperature of that gas is only 15 degrees. And it's a dry air without any humidity. But what we need to give for these preterm units is a gas which is 37 degrees and 100% humidity. Because that can reduce the heat and water loss, preserve the gas exchange, preserve the energy, reduce the risk of infection and import, improve the mucociliary transport system. So this is dangerous, wherein you give oxygen directly through the nasal cannula without heating and humidification, because this can damage the baby's epithelium. So whenever baby needs oxygen, it has to be a heated and humidified gas. And what ventilation strategy should we follow? CPAP is the preferred initial method of non-invasive respiratory support, and we need to use heated and humidified gas. With regard to mechanical ventilation, if at all baby goes on to ventilation, whenever possible, we have to use the volume-targeted ventilation, because now we know volutrauma is more harmful than barotrauma or atelectrotrauma or biotrauma. Don't aim for a CO2 of 30 or 35. Permissive hypercapnia is accepted. Even if your CO2 is 50, 55, be happy, because otherwise you'll end up banging the lungs with too much of pressure, causing more damage. Avoid hypoxia as well as hyperoxia. And whenever you get an opportunity to extubate early, if the pressures are down, if the FiO2 is down, if baby has good respiratory drive, yes. And always choose non-invasive ventilation. Cardiovascular system support is very important in order to prevent IVH. So we have to monitor all these babies once they're inside the NICU, heart rate, capillary refill, and BP. And if needed, these babies, we need to get an early IV access, give an NS bolus, 10 ml per kilo. And if there is unresponsiveness to the fluid bolus, we go ahead with vasopressors, because hemodynamic instability can predispose to IVH. Our IVH rate in our NICU is very, very low, even if we deal with 25-26 weekers, because we follow most of these protocols. And early nutrition support is a must. They are at risk of hypoglycemia. Do a sugar immediately. Start dextrose infusion. Start TPN, especially lipids and protein on day one, because it will prevent catabolism. Tropic feed must on day one, because it will get the gut going and prevent NEC. And if you have any difficulty in access, get an UVC done as early as possible, because UVC early is better than late, because the colonization of umbilical cord will happen. So earlier UVC will have lesser risk of infection and less number of pricks to the baby. And most important, so though we do all these steps, the most important step is prevention and treatment of sepsis. We have to do good hand washing before we go for resuscitation and before we do any procedure for a preterm unit. Because strict asepsis method is a key in all the NICU. And we should follow a bundle approach whenever we are doing a central line surfactant and TPN administration. And if there is a suspicion of sepsis, like the mother has got a chorioamnionitis, prolonged rupture of membranes, and the preterm labor, start antibiotics as early as possible. Within first 1 hour, if you're suspecting early onset sepsis, don't delay antibiotics after constant culture. So other interventions that are useful are extreme preterm units have very fragile skin, so do take care of the skin, because skin integrity is very important to prevent infection, because it can become a portal of entry for infection. So take care of the skin well. Do lab investigations early, do a count culture and x-ray. Monitor and record heart rate, respiratory rate, temperature, capillary refill, blood pressure, saturation, and sugar. And last but not the least, once you're done, go back to the family, sit with the family, tell them what you have done, and give them an overall purview of what you expect from the unit. So there are a lot of quality improvement projects which have happened all across the world based on golden hour management. What they have found is there's improved birth to surfactant administrative time, improved admission temperature, sooner administration of TPN, sooner administration of antibiotics, earlier administration of catheters, decrease in IVH, decrease in IVH. So these are all based on, like, they start an intervention and they look at what has happened over the last 3 years, and they look at what has happened after the change in the protocol. So this, we cannot do a randomized trial. We just see what has happened before and later after we do an intervention. So this is again one trial which was showed post-protocol patients, they had a higher, better admission temperature, better glucose, and earlier IV access compared to babies for pre-protocol. So this is an algorithm which is from University of North Carolina. As you can see, for the first, before birth, we need to do counseling and assign the team members. During birth, we need to follow NRP, delivery room CPAP, and prevent hypothermia with placing hat and plastic wrap. And once the baby is weaned to NICU, take care of respiratory care, secure an IV line, do investigation as early as possible, obtain an UA or UV access if needed, early respiratory support, early cardiovascular support, and early nutrition and trophic feeds. So this is a golden hour script wherein here we say what are the responsibilities that we need to give to different team members. So this can be customized to your own institution wherein this will be the chief person who will say what all needs to be done. This will be the respiratory therapist, or if you have a junior doctor, a nurse, one a nurse. So everybody should be given a specific role at different points of time so that they'll know what they have to do and they'll complete the schedule. So this golden hour management can have a significant impact on the outcome in a preterm baby, both mortality as well as morbidity. So the my take-home message would be to concentrate on all the components, especially antenatal counseling, forming a team, brief the team, give them the responsibility. Very simple, easy is to do delayed cord clamping for all deliveries, especially preterm units, which is much more helpful for preterm than term baby. Prevention of hypothermia, support the respiratory system early with delivery room CPAP, make sure you don't give hyperoxia. Saturation of 90 to 95 is more than enough in the NICU. Support the cardiovascular system, which can prevent your IVH. Early TPN, prevention of hypoglycemia and trophic feeds for nutritional care. Very important is prevention of infection and early antibiotics. Also take care of skin, do early labs, monitor, and counsel the family. Thank you.
Nice presentation.
Thank you, sir. The hall is open for discussion. Any questions from the audience?
NEOPUF provide heated and humidified air?
No.
It's for the initial.
Yeah. So when you're contemplating to give an oxygen for a longer period of time, we